Hi everybody. So today is a really interesting topic for me. So I normally do living the shit out of life, your story in art with other people, and I interview them and I take their memorabilia and really transform their story into 3D art. But unfortunately, due to the situation with COVID-19, all being in our homes, I can't be in contact with people closely and interview them, and then I can't collect their memorabilia either. We're just trying to be safe and smart, and with doing that, we're going to be, stay at home and do what we need to do and find the creative ways to go about our, normal daily routine. So for me, I've been thinking about really how to showcase the stories moving forward while quarantined, and I thought, why don't I just take some of the stories and some of the people that I've been inspired by, I normally do that anyway, but you're going to hear more of it from me than you are about the other person. So starting with this story, it's a really unique one because there's a chef, his name is Yotam Ottolenghi, and he's Israeli, but lives in the UK. He has different restaurants, within London, and I think he is a food wizard. I think he's so brilliant when doing combinations and concoctions with different food ingredients. And I'm an artist and I love to cook, but I'm definitely a better artist than I am a chef. Even though I can follow a lot of recipes, it's very hard for me to, if I'm standing there in front of a chopped basket, for people that watch the Food Network, you know what that is. That's way harder for me than if you put just random ingredients in front of, or materials in front of my face as an artist. That's my specialty. That's what I know how to do. But when I jump over to food, I definitely need recipes and guidance. I can execute from there. Yeah, so when I found Ottolenghi's recipes, I was in a very challenging time in my life. You know, when I talk about these stories of living the shit out of life, your story in art, I really started this platform based on highlighting stories of triumph over adversity, because I just think there's such beauty in these stories and such a special human quality and unique quality, and I really wanted to show the combination of all of the emotions that really go into these stories. And so with me, I developed a situation where I became allergic to 90% of the things that were going in my mouth or on my skin. And it's a condition called Mast Cell Activation Syndrome. It took me a very long time to figure it out, but very long story short, I became allergic to 90% of food. So I couldn't eat like a normal human being does. And the difference is with a peanut allergy or something, like, you know that you have a peanut allergy. With this condition, you just never know. It's really about your immune system being very confused and just not having a direct pathway of, guiding your body properly. So for me, when I was going through my treatment, I would visualize eating Ottolenghi's food. His look at his books. They're just so beautiful. So Plenty is one of his first books. And just look at that. I mean, you want to eat the cover. And so it's so beautifully done. And from an artistic standpoint, I just love everything about it. But what happens is when you actually make the ingredients come together like he does, I mean, it's just a taste that's so special and so unique. And I would take the books with me to my doctor's office while I was getting my IV treatments, and I would just look through the books. It makes me so happy and makes me visualize that I was going to eat at Ottolenghi's restaurant one day in London. That is definitely on my vision board and definitely a big goal of mine. With what's going on in the world today, this COVID-19 situation has put a lot of stress and a lot of challenge within the restaurant and within the culinary community. I read an article from Ottolenghi recently in The Guardian in the UK, and he was talking about how these restaurants can't keep up because they're still expecting rents, the landlords are still expecting rents, and the owners can't keep up because they're not getting enough money to come in because the restaurants are shut down and they're really suffering. So knowing how much Ottolenghi helped me in my journey, I really wanted to do something to try to give back to him and to the community that he supports, that I thought, why not? Why not? Let's try to make an art piece out of food-based materials, and something I've never done before, so it's definitely a new challenge for me. I used some of the materials in my kitchen that were either expired or, you know, just the rinds of a lemon versus the whole lemon. So I really tried not to waste any food because it's so vital and important right now. And so I really wanted to try to test, you know, the artistic boundaries of what food products can do. And the next goal with it is to not only create something beautiful, but also to use it as a vehicle for purpose, and that's to raise awareness for the community in London and the rest of the world, and for all the people in the culinary world and people who own restaurants and people who work in restaurants. These are livelihoods that need to be taken care of. So I'm going to start a GoFundMe campaign with this art piece and really try to get viral attention on social media to have people help contribute to keep the restaurant culinary world alive and thriving within the world. So I really hope that this energy continues and really supports where it needs to. I'm hopeful. So thanks for listening to my story. I'm excited to continue more stories with you. And we're gonna test new ways of how to go about you know, creativity within quarantine. So one day at a time, and that's all we can do. We wanted to utilize at the best we can with what we have at home, not going out, buying anything new. And so I went into my pantry today to see if, you know, some of the things that I could possibly use that could act like paint and just natural substances that would be edible, but transforming them into art. So here we are, food art. And so I'll show you some of the things that I found. Since we're focusing on Ottolenghi today, he's known for using a lot of tahini. I found some sesame seeds that were older, and you can see here, so little, just, you know, white sesame seeds that are expired. Here I have some turmeric powder. Some people call it turmeric. I juiced I made some juice for myself today, and this was excess carrot juice that, you know, I kept a little left over from my juice that I had today. And then here, paprika. Again, just, you know, this kind of darker rustic color, burnt umber color. And then I had some leftover older beet powder for this kind of maroon color that I think could be really pretty. I do have a lemon. Ottolenghi is known for lemons. I mean, he wears a lemon on his t-shirt all the time, and it's on his books. And so I'm just going to use the rind of this. I'm not going to use the whole lemon because, again, we're going to be conscious of, you know, saving the ingredients that we can actually use with food. And today I found some expired green matcha tea. This is a first, you guys. And for me, it's always, I love challenging ingredients. That's number one. I love challenging ingredients. I love challenging materials. I love to go to the unknown. I mean, for me, it's the most exciting thing. And I've driven a lot of people crazy in my life because of it, because if I need help or if I was in school and people didn't understand what I was doing, I'm like, can't you see it? Don't you understand? We can go there. And they're like, but no, that's not supposed to be there. But I'm like, why not? This is one of those moments where I'm like, why not? Let's just try it. And you know what? The materials will tell us if they're supposed to work or not. And that's what I love about it. It's really just being completely free with the technique and seeing where life takes you, where the road takes you. And so today I tried this green matcha paste. And let me tell you guys, so I just started with, you know, putting some color, which I love the color that it gave. You can see it just turns out like a watercolor, but man, it stinks. It is stinky. And so I am going to put that outside because I'm done with the matcha. I don't want to smell this anymore. It's pretty potent. I did put a drop of vinegar in there to see what the acid would do. What the acid is doing right now is kind of making me nauseous, so I'll be right back. I'm going to take that outside. I'm back. So I think the next one I want to test is the turmeric. It's this orange color. It's really pretty color. I'm just gonna put some water in there and then stir it around. I'm gonna take this bigger brush here and we're just gonna put the orange. Oh, it's really pretty. Beautiful, actually, this color. And I'm just going to do, you know, as if I was to do a watercolor painting. You'll see that has a different smell. What's interesting about all of this, because they're food products, is that they're completely different sensation to the nose and to the board of this as well. Like how they actually go on the board here. It's not like paint at all. And it's not like a paint powder at all either. It's a little clumpy. But what it really reminds me of, and something I used to do as a young girl and really what started my career in art, is watercolor painting. And that's how I'm treating this, is that it's a truly watercolor experience. And so that's that combination, which I think is going nicely. So next color, I'm gonna try this carrot juice. we'll see what happens. I have no idea, but again, you can't really mess up, right? Like, art gives you a lot of leniency to just test the boundaries, see where you can go with everything. My goal is to not make everything turn into one big brown lump of color. That's when you know you're going to the danger zone, is when things just start looking muddy and brown. But I actually like what this carrot juice is doing. It's acting like a stain, and it's actually really nice. And I wouldn't have thought that. Actually, it's like also a deeper color than I was thinking. And again, it's drying differently, and it's drying differently on top of this matcha color. So I'm gonna treat this as a tie-dye. That's what the end outcome is gonna be with this, is like a tie-dye. And so I'm gonna show you in a second. And these products need, I think, a bit of drying time, like any product. But because they are food-based, I think that keeping them in place for a longer period of time is a good idea, so they can set well. I say that, but now I'm gonna raise it up to show you guys, but that's okay. So I actually like that. See, like, whoa! Now I'm gonna actually turn that like that, and you can see, whoa, it's dripping everywhere. All right, we're gonna set that down for a second and let that set. But I do like what happened. Got a little over the, you know, on the floor. But all right, now we're gonna go with the beet. So I don't think I'm gonna put any liquid in the beet. I think I'm just going to dip the wet brush into the beet powder and just get, and see, you have to be careful because the beet color is like this purple plum color. And mixed in with the green matcha, it can turn into a very muddy situation here. So you want to go drier versus adding a lot of water to it. But it's so beautiful, you guys. Like, it just shows you the true beauty in all materials, no matter what form. And I'm kind of a purist when it comes to food by choice, but also you know, just through my own health situations in life, they've guided me to be a very pure eater. And so I really appreciate the purity of product, period. You know, it's just, say, you're not going to get more pure than using these basic colors coming from the earth and from the food of the land and so forth. So powder is also leaving little specks. And it's actually very nice, and it's almost staining the same way a tie-dye experience would. So, all right, I think we're safe now to lift that up with the carrot juice. So here. So that's really nice. You can see this combination. And I like that it's dripping down like that, just like a tie-dye situation would. Ottolenghi has various cookbooks. They're also beautiful. I mean, the pictures alone, they just, you just want to eat the cover. And I just look at this. I mean, everything about it is so vibrant, colorful, beautiful. And there's these designs in the book that are these illustrations of food. And I think I really appreciate everything he does because there's so much detail in his presentation. And you can see when someone cares and loves what they do and they're so passionate about what they do, it comes through. I mean, you can't, it's so authentic. You can't hide it. It's really the truth coming out at you. So I'm going to take a page in his book and I'm going to do something that's a little sacrilegious to the foodies out there that follow him. But for the sake of art, that's what I got to do. So here we go. So I'm just going to tear that out. Yikes. I know. We should not do that. But we're going to tear these up and we're going to make a collage out of his actual work. And so I'm just going to keep, you know, here is a page that I tore earlier today and some potato egg dish with some mint, I can tell, and some peas. And so we're just going to keep tearing them up with the recipe on the back. And what I love about doing this process is that you're actually truly incorporating that recipe, that creation, that artistic element that this chef put his, you know, hard work and sweat and tears into, and combining that into this really beautiful background of, you know, kind of this evolution of seeing where something new will take us, and hopefully that when we're all said and done with this, the evolution of what this is going to do is continue, you know, evolving the spirit and the passion and the love and the creativity of chefs and people that work in the restaurant business. And I mean, everybody essentially, but our goal today is to really focus on the community that is very creative around food. And so that's what I love about everything that we're working on right now is you take one story, hopefully it enlightens and inspires somebody else's story. And that continuation of life just keeps going and gets brighter and fuller and expands in a really beautiful way. So I have these edible roses. So Ottolenghi uses a lot of roses in his recipes, in harissa, rose cookies, rose desserts, rose flavored desserts. So I really wanted to incorporate some rose essence into this artwork. I'm just really trying to highlight what I feel that really represents him as an artist and a chef. So, all right, the next step is that I cut the lemon rinds. I did not waste the lemon. There's the lemon. I just cut the rinds off. And so I cut them in little slivered pieces. So I'm going to write the word save. Okay, so with my second canvas, I took the lemon rinds and I created the word save. So we're gonna focus on saving something, which is the restaurant industry around the world. Specifically with this project, with Ottolenghi, he's in the UK, but this energy that we're creating right now to utilize kitchen foods, to utilize creativity within the food industry, that's what we're doing right now. We are spreading our creative energy to help those creative people within the restaurant industry. So chefs, the people that work in, you know, the restaurants, everybody affiliated within the restaurant industry, we are trying to help save them. And so that is really profound. I mean, it's using the element that we work with, the lemon, that, you know, really represents that we are making lemonade from lemons that life is giving to us right now. And I think that it's very significant. So I really enjoy working with the lemon right now. It represents a lot for me personally. So when I look at this, I get very happy thinking that I am personally helping to contribute to, you know, making lemonade for other people's life too, when, you know, lemons are really truly being handed right now. So lemons don't have to be a bad thing anyway. You know, we're just gonna try to make the best of what we can and we're going to try to make something that's tart into very sweet and delicious. These little ripped sheets of his recipes from his cookbook. This one happened to be from Plenty, but I have all the cookbooks here. One of my favorites is sweet. The dessert, there's a maple apple cake. I'm telling you, I couldn't even believe my taste buds when I tasted it. So you gotta try it. These are, again, just little scraps that I made from his pages. And, you know, look, out of all of them, I feel like I'm, you know, picking lottery words. It says surprise. So we're gonna get a surprise out of this. And I'm excited to see the final outcome because I don't know what it's gonna look like. You guys don't know what it's gonna look like. So it's gonna be a surprise for all of us. You ready to see the final outcome? I'm super excited to show it to you. This is my food art project, first attempt final. And there it is. So it says, save Ottolenghi. And I'll just walk through each step that I went through here. So save, if you can see it up close, those are the lemon rinds. I added some rhinestones. And then I have this window box here. You can see the roses on the side. Those are dried roses, and the recipes, the torn up recipes, it's around the frame. And inside there, it's paprika and beet powder and lemon rinds and some rhinestones and some rose petals. And then going down, this is all ripped recipes. So Ottolenghi is super long, so it didn't fit on the smaller board. So I cut it up and I made it a bit more abstract on the bottom. And as you know, I use any material that I can find. So I found these earrings and I added some dried roses to the earrings down there to add some new dimension and just basically, you know, showing that you can use anything at home that you have and be creative in any which way. So this is what I'm thinking. Oh, I forgot the background. So this watercolor, I really love how it turned out. I think it was so beautiful. This background is matcha, which was stinky, and then the beetroot, and then turmeric, and so I really love how it all turned out. It's a stain. I mean, that's really what these products showed me, is that they really truly act like stain paint. So the one thing that I will tell you, which I'm not very happy about, is that because I use food product, it collects ants, and so because there's flowers and food, I came into the studio and I saw ants crawling around, which I was not happy about. It's all par for the course. So we tried something new. So here's what I want to do with this. I've been thinking about it and where I would like to take this project, because I was asked to do another one next week with some local chefs. I really want to utilize this as a GoFundMe campaign to create awareness and to help create funds for starting with the restaurants in London and around surrounding areas. But instead of auctioning off this piece, I want to take the pieces that I do during this quarantine time and actually create an art show when this is all said and done, and create an art show of all the pieces together and showcase them in an art gallery. So, or, you know, just an art showing. That's one, but I'm still going to create the GoFundMe page to raise, again, awareness and funds for international chefs as well as local chefs and whoever we can help in the culinary arts right now. And this exciting part that I think that would be so much fun, really, is that if we all combine together, all of us creating food art. So if you have any materials that you're juicing with or cooking with that are left over or some expired ingredients, I think it would be so fun to see what your food art looks like. So I'm gonna create this challenge where I say to you, let's add another element of creativity to our day. If you have time, I know a lot of people are super busy right now, but if you have time and you feel like doing something new and challenging yourself to really, you know, living the shit out of life as best as possible, I think this would be a fun challenge. So I would love to see your artwork. So this is how you can find the GoFundMe page. You go to Art by Shanna, which is artxshanna.com. You go to Living the Shit Out of Life. Under that button, you'll see Ottolenghi, and you'll see a GoFundMe campaign. there, and that's where you can donate money. I will have all of this information at the end of this video, and it's been super fun working with all of you. I've loved experiencing this moment in time with you, and I hope to see some of your food art. I would love to see it. So I'm waiting. I'm waiting. And I will keep you posted with the new food art projects that I will continue to do in the future. So thanks. Oh, look, I see an ant right now. All right. Well, anyway, thanks so much. I'll talk to you soon.